I'll keep my remarks very short so you have more time for your questions. As you, I think, all know, this is my very first trip to Singapore, but it's not a country that I find very alien, because so many Burmese people have so many contacts with this country that it feels very familiar. And there are many Burmese working here. There, a couple of days ago, I met some of them. I understand there were about nearly 6,000, but that's, I think, less than half of the total population of our countrymen here. I was very happy to meet them, to find out what they were doing here. And I have been very happy to find so much warmth in the welcome of our friends from Singapore. One gets used to thinking of Singapore as a financial, a commercial city, where people are more intent on business and money than human relations. But I have to say that I was pleasantly surprised to find that there is a lot of human warmth going around this place. And I think this should be the best and greatest tie between our two countries, a bond that is based on caring for one another as people who belong to the same region, and also as peoples who have been through the same experience. We do share many similarities in the history of our two countries, our struggle, our experience under colonialism, and I'm sure we have much to learn from one another. There are those who may wonder what Singapore has to learn from Burma, but just wait and see. Thank you. First of all, I think I must say that this constitution has to be changed if we are ready to make the transition to democracy. Sooner or later, that is a question, and the sooner the better. Your question is, what would happen if it is not changed before 2015? We would have to go on with the movement, the push to change the constitution. But what happens before, if it is not changed for 2015, will depend on what other things happen. Because constitutional amendment is not the only change that is necessary in our country. So I think it would be a bit premature for me to say now, if the constitution is not changed until 2015, this will happen or that will happen. But I can say, I think, with great confidence, that if the constitution is not changed before 2015, there will be more problems than we would have if it were to be changed in time. I would challenge you to show me another party in Burma that is as capable as the NLD. I think in many ways I can say that the NLD is the most effective political party in Burma, and this is the only party to date that has been constructed democratically. We had a party congress which started at the level of the villages, and all the officials of the NLD are elected in a democratic way. And I would challenge you to show me another political party in Burma that is built along the same lines. And I'm confident of the capacity of my party to carry the people with us. And that is what is important.
Thank you. Sir? Here. That's you, the gentleman in the blue shirt.
Mark Kaufman from Swiss paper, NZZ. I would like to ask you about the past. How should Burma deal with its past and its human rights violations? Would you be in favor of a kind of reconciliation and truth commission, or how would you suggest should this human rights violation be dealt with?
I often like to quote something written by a scholar that that history should be an inspiration and not a prison. It is the same with our past. Our past should provide us with the strength to face the present and the future, and not to shackle us in tackling with the problems that we have to face now. I have never been for vengeance, but I think truth has to be faced. I think many people in my country just want the truth to be recognized, the truth to be faced. I do not think that the great majority of our people are out for vengeance. I cannot say that there is nobody in Burma who does not want vengeance. I'm sure they are. This is only human nature. But I'm confident that the majority of our people do not want vengeance. What they want is reconciliation and peace and unity. But they do want the peace, the truth to be recognized and accepted.
Great. Can we be fair? Now I move to this side. Yes. Lady in black, thank you very much.
Hello, Dosu. Hello. Nice to meet you. I'm Pell from Hong Kong Economic Times. So I'm from Hong Kong. Actually, we've met during the MAS summit a few days ago. And in Hong Kong, we are planning a campaign called Occupy Central. It is a nonviolent occupation protest for universal suffrage that is going to take place in our financial area in Hong Kong in the middle of next year. It's kind of similar to Occupy Wall Street a few years ago. However, some people worry that it will destroy Hong Kong economy and the status as financial center. In your view, what is your opinion in such a nonviolent campaign, and how do we balance democracy and develop an economic development? Thank you.
Well, we're not a financial center in Burma, so we don't have that problem. But I think it's a balance. In democracy, it's always a balance between rights and responsibilities. This is what I always say. It's not a balance between economics and politics, as some people seem to think. You know, either you go in for political democracy or you go in for economic prosperity. I don't think that is it. If you want to build up a democracy that will actually benefit your people, you have to balance rights and responsibilities all the time. And this is what I always say. I've never tried to win over people to support our party by saying, we will give you so many rights that we will make sure that you get all the rights possible. I always say, yes, you will have rights under democracy, but you will have many responsibilities as well. And you must be prepared to discharge them. And this decision, whether or not you're going to occupy the financial center of your city, is something that you yourself must take, all of you, each individual one of you who belong to Hong Kong and who care for its future. You must decide for yourself what your rights are, what the rights to which you are entitled are, what are the rights to which you have the right to aspire, and then weigh that against the responsibilities you have towards maintaining the peace and stability and prosperity of the city. It is up to you. I cannot give you this advice. If the same thing were to happen in Burma, I would have to think very, very hard as to what would be the right answer, depending on circumstances prevailing at that time.
Hi, I'm Sian Boon from Today newspaper. I'd just like to ask Ms. Dosu, you've declared your intention to run for presidency in 2015. I'd just like to ask, what have you managed to achieve in the past year since you've been elected into parliament? And what are your goals from now till 2015?
First of all, I cannot run for the presidency because the president in Burma under the president constitution is not directly elected. I've just said very simply that I would like to be president if I could be. Because, of course, you can do a lot more as a president than as the leader of the opposition. Now, you ask me what I have done so far. Now, I, of course, am the chair of the NLD, and I'm also the representative for Komhu Township in the lower house of our legislature. I could tell you a lot about what I have done in my township, and I'm very proud of that, because I think if you get yourself elected as a representative, you have to discharge your duties to that constituency, to those people who voted for you. In my constituency, we have provided a lot more water. We've dug a lot of wells established pumps. We have constructed a lot of new all-weather roads. Our hospital, it now has more doctors than they had before I came in as MP. And we have made many repairs to it. We've provided it with an ambulance. We've started the first mobile library in Burma, centered in my township, and that is doing extremely well. And we are starting to build a vocational school, which I hope we'll be able to open at the beginning of next year. We've been able to help to improve our schools there. And I may have forgotten a few other things, but I don't think it's too bad for 18 months. And with regard to my party itself, as the chair of the party, as I mentioned earlier, we've been able to hold our first party congress in the history of the party. When we were founded in 1988, but never allowed to operate as a genuine political party. So for the first time, we managed to hold a party congress last year because we wanted to make sure that our party was founded on the principles of democracy. And of course, there are bickerings within the party, and this is, and people point at our party and say, look at the NLD. There are lots of people arguing and shouting at one another. That is because they don't understand what a democratic party is. It's only in an authoritarian system, in a one-party system, that you get only one voice coming out of a party. And the very fact that the problems of our party are public is a sign of our democratic way, which is accountable and transparent. And now, as a member of the legislature, apart from what I have done for my constituency, I chair the committee for the rule of law and tranquility, also the committee for the renovation and reinvigoration of Rangoon General Hospital, mm-hmm. and the committee for the reinvigoration and renovation of Rangoon University. And I also chair the committee working on the higher education law. And I was chair of the commission looking into the copper mines project in central Burma. Mm-hmm. We've completed that task. I've presented the report. So I think I work reasonably hard.
Very good. I'll pass the mic to a gentleman, because if not, people will say I'm biased. Sure, over the left. All right. Thank you.
Dosu, Jeremy from the Straits Times. I was just wondering if you could comment a little about your meetings with the Singapore leaders this morning, and also where do you see the cooperation between Myanmar and Singapore go moving forward?
Well, first of all, I generally don't discuss what I have talked about with anybody in general. I consider those private meetings, and of course, if they wish to bring out a statement, that is very much up to them. But as a matter of principle, I don't discuss my conversations with leaders of government or ministers or leaders of political parties. But about relations between Singapore and Burma, I'm quite happy to talk about that. Of course, a lot of Burmese look to Singapore when they think of economic reforms in our country, because they see the success of Singapore. And also many of our young people are getting their education here. So these are the sectors in which many of our people feel they can learn from Singapore. But as I said, I think also Singapore will have things to learn from us, because this is very much a city-state. We are not a city-state. And we are basically an agriculture state. And we want our country to be different. And we want this difference to add to the versatile, the diversity of the world. So I think perhaps Singapore could learn from us a more relaxed way of life. perhaps warmer and closer family relationships. I think we have much to offer you. You come and find out.
Great, thank you. Chan Karudan Kanan, mic for him, please. Thank you.
Hi, Kanan Chandran from Storm Magazine. Please correct me if I'm wrong, but I read somewhere that you once said government leaders are amazing. So often it seems they are the last to know what people want. Is that something you still feel is true?
Well, for some government leaders, it's certainly very true. I think they get very distant from the people. But this is particularly in countries where democracy is not practiced. Because in countries where democracy is practiced to some degree, the elections make it necessary for the leaders to try to learn what the people really want. But in my country, where we lived under a military dictatorship for about half a century, you can see just by looking at the last two elections we had, how distant the leaders were from the people. There was the elections in 2012, the by-elections, and I'm sorry, not the last, the last two, but the ones in 2012 and the ones back in 1990. Now, if you look at those two elections, you can see that our leaders were totally out of touch with the people and were surprised by the results. In 1990, they were surprised by the fact that the NLD won 82% of the seats in the legislature. In 2012, they were surprised by the fact that in the by-elections, we won 96% of the seats going, which was only 45. But still, 96% is a good record. So I think leaders do get divorced from the aspirations of the people. I've just come back from the Corruption Investigation Bureau just to find out what they did in Singapore. Corruption, of course, is a very serious issue. But as I was discussing then, I'm happy that although corruption is rampant in Burma, the people in general still do not think of corruption as an acceptable way of life. It has become almost a way of life. But our people have a memory of the time when we had a government that was not corrupt. We had an administration that was not corrupt. And our people still view corruption as something reprehensible. Something unavoidable, maybe, but reprehensible. For example, just to get a document that you need for official purposes, quite often you have to bribe the civil servant concerned to get it done quickly enough. And these are the little practices that crept in and have spread all over the country. But people don't like it. Just because they have got used to it, it does not mean that they have grown to like it. Mm. And for me, that's a big plus in favor of dealing with corruption in my country. As I was told at the Bureau, you will never be able to get rid of corruption entirely. It exists still, even in Singapore, because it's part of human nature. It's part of human nature to give in to temptation. And so I suppose we must assume that in my country too, there will always be corruption of some kind to some extent, but we do want to root out corruption to the extent that our people are able to lead secure lives, confident that they will be protected by the law if they behave correctly, if they live within the law, and they will not be subject to extortions by unscrupulous officials or other organizations.
Thank you. The lady, and then one more from the other side. Yes, the lady in front of the gentleman in orange. Thank you.
Dosu, this is Shibani from the Wall Street Journal. I'd just like to ask, how would you describe your relationship with the military at present, and do you get any sense whether they might support your bid for presidency in 2015? Thank you.
It's very. I think what I'll have to do is this. Instead of describing my relationship with the army, I can only tell you how I feel about the army, and how I hope they feel about me. I've always said that I harbor no resentment against the army. That in fact, I have an affection for it, and people have attacked me for saying this, and I don't know why. I've always said this since 1988, when I entered politics. I've said that I will never lose my affection for the army, because I was taught from birth that my father was the father of the army, and I was taught to look upon soldiers as my relatives, my brothers, if you like, but as I grew older, more like my sons. But this is something that was bred into my bones. And also because I have great hopes that one day this army can once again be the kind of institution that we so honored and loved at one time. I have total confidence in that. Now, as to how the military feels about me, I think you must understand that the military is made up of a lot of people. The official figure is 500,000, but I'm told that actually it's rather less than that. But whatever, I cannot speak for how 500,000 people might feel about me, but I'm confident that there are people in the army who want it to be a professional institution, such as it used to be, that was confident of the people's love and respect. And I'm sure that there are very many people in the army who would rather that our country was under a clean civilian government rather than a questionable military one.
Thank you. One final question, yeah, from the back. Can we have? That's right. Thank you.
Rachel Armstrong from Reuters. I was just wondering if you could elaborate a little bit further on some of the specific institutions here in Singapore or policies you've seen that, that you'd like to very much learn from and perhaps try and recreate in Burma.
I don't think recreate is a word. Learn, yes. For example, the education system in Singapore. I went to the Technical Institute today, and I was very interested. And I also discussed Singapore in education in Singapore with representatives of the Ministry of Education. And I made a remark after listening to the presentation that education in Singapore, as in many other countries, seems to be workforce-oriented. Now, that made me think, what is work all about? What are human beings for? What are human lives about? And so I want to learn a lot from the standards that Singapore has been able to achieve. But I wonder whether I don't want something more for our country. Now, what is the purpose of the workforce? What is the purpose of work? What is the purpose of material wealth? Is that the ultimate aim of human beings? Is that what we all want? So in a sense, I think I want to probe more into the successes of Singapore and to find out what we can achieve beyond that. Because I think that the human capacity for progress is limitless. And I'm not talking about just material progress. In my country, we survived over the last decades of great difficulty, not because we had material props, but there were other props that we had, our spiritual props, our love for our comrades, our loyalty towards our values, our commitments. So there were many things that helped us to survive that had very little to do with material achievement. But I realized that material achievement is important and our people must be secure materially. They must be free from want as they must be free from fear.
I think that was a wonderful conclusion. I'm so sorry, that was the last question. All right, would you like to take that question, Aung Su? Okay, fine. You've been putting up your hand the whole time.
Thank you. Madam, good afternoon. I'm Miro Lu from CCTV News. I know you're not a big fan to talk about business and materialism, as you just mentioned, but I think it's very much in line with what you said yesterday at SMU, what your people want. You said they want jobs, they want water, roads, electricity, education, and health. And my question is, Chinese investment in Myanmar has fallen sharply since 2011. I guess the question is, how can China, or how should China help Myanmar and its people? Thank you very much.
I must correct you a little and say that it's not that I don't want to talk about business. It's all I seem to have to talk about. And so sometimes I want to change. A lot of people who come to see me in Burma see me about business, about investments. And at the Singapore summit, of course, the larger part of the discussions were about business. Now, you talk about the falling investments of China. I do not think it's something that you should worry about, because I think what we should think of is business as quality and not as quantity. Let us think of future business between our two countries as business that would improve relations between our peoples. I have to confess that there was a lot of resentment over the last couple of decades, because there were people who believed that Chinese businesses were helping the military regime to retain its power. And that created resentments, that created hard feelings. But the fact that Chinese businesses are investing less now, I think is less important than the possibility of Chinese businesses investing in a more responsible way and a more responsive way to the needs of our people. And that will improve relations between our two countries in a way in which no investment could do. So don't worry about that. I do believe that the friendship between our two countries will be strong and enduring.